Hello, dear learners. Today we are going to have a discussion on dimensions of learning, and this is the first part of the discussion. I'm Dr. Aerum Khan from Jamia Millia Islamia. I work as an assistant professor in IASC Faculty of Education of Jamia. So now we just start the discussion on what are the dimensions of learning. What do we mean by the dimensions of learning? So dimensions of learning, basically, it's a comprehensive model that uses what researchers and theorists know about learning to define the learning process. It is an extension of the comprehensive research-based framework on cognition and learning, which was described by Marzano et al. In 1988. This was done in a through a very famous work of them by these people as Dimensions of Thinking, a Framework for Curriculum and Instruction. So now let us see what exactly they have actually discovered. The five dimensions of learning are essential to successful learning. So the dimensions framework will help a student or a teacher to maintain a focus on learning, study the learning process, and plan the curriculum, instruction, and assessment that takes into account the five critical aspects of learning. So now we just see one by one that what exactly these dimensions are. So the first dimension which will be studied here, we are going to discuss on, is the attitudes and perceptions. Attitudes and perceptions affect students' abilities to learn. For example, if a student view the classroom as an unsafe and clumsy place, the student will likely learn very little. Because she will be not very much comfortable in that environment. Similarly, if students have negative attitudes about classroom task or whatever is assigned to her in the class, they will probably put little effort into those tasks. A key element of effective instruction then is to helping students to establish positive attitudes and perceptions about the classroom and about learning process. So now, basically, whenever we are talking about the dimension of attitudes and perceptions, we have to see basically two things. So the first thing is related to the classroom climate. Under the classroom climate, we have to see the acceptance by teachers and peer group. Like if a child is in a class, she should be or he should be accepted by the teacher and the friends or the peer group. Then the second thing under the classroom climate is the comfort and order which is maintained in the classroom. So how comfortable the girl or the boy is in the classroom setup is also very important for effective learning. Then under these this particular dimension of attitudes and perceptions, the second aspect is the classroom tasks which are assigned to a student inside the classroom. So in the classroom task, we have to see that what are the values and interests which are enshrined in the those particular assignments which are given to the students by the teachers. So values and interests are very much important, and the ability and resources. So we as a teacher have to see that if we are assigning a task in our class, then whether the previous knowledge, the ability to complete that task is there in the students or not. It's our responsibility that we first work on the creating the ability or basically enhancing the ability of the child so that he or she can accomplish the task. And also provide the resources which are important and which are actually the must if the child is supposed to work on a particular assignment. Then under this classroom tasks category, the next thing is the clarity of the task which is assigned to the child. If the child is not understanding that what exactly is to be done in this assignment, again there will be a confusion and there will be a kind of negative attitude which will be implanted in the child regarding the task. So we as a teacher have to be very much cautious about this particular thing, that whenever we are providing an assignment, we are giving an assignment to a child or to a student, the clarity of the assignment should be very much there. So this was the first dimension, which is basically the attitudes and perceptions. So now we move on to the second dimension, which is to acquire and integrate knowledge. So the second dimension says that when the students are learning new knowledge, they must be guided in relation to the new knowledge, to what they are already knowing. So whenever we are launching or we are actually introducing a new topic in a class, we have to make sure that we actually integrate that particular new knowledge with what exactly is actually known to the students. So the previous knowledge is to be integrated with the new thing. Otherwise, it will be very difficult for a student to actually understand that new thing. So because whenever a new topic is introduced, the students start making links with whatever they have actually studied earlier. So they organize that particular new knowledge and then make it part of their long-term memory. When students are acquiring new skills and processes, they must learn a model or a set of steps, then shape the skill or process to make it efficient and effective for them, and finally internalize or practice the skill or process so they can perform it easily. It means that whenever we are actually introducing a new topic, they should actually, the motive of this particular class when a new topic is introduced is that the children, the students internalize that particular concept or this piece of knowledge. For that purpose, we have to actually first see that what exactly is known to them previously. Then there should be a kind of a training or kind of knowledge enhancement in terms of letting them understand that what exactly is the process, so that whenever they see that thing next time, they can just make a kind of attempt of making it like reproduced or making it recalled, that exactly this is the thing which I have learned earlier and now this is something which is related to it. So in this way, they will internalize the process so that this particular new knowledge will be basically learned to them in an easy way. So this dimension basically it is having a lot of steps. So whenever we are talking about acquiring and integrating knowledge, the first thing is actually making a declarative attempt. Whenever we are making a declarative attempt, we are making the construction of meaning of that particular new knowledge. A child makes a construction of meaning, which is making an association with whatever is learned to this person in the earlier topics. Then the child organizes this new knowledge, and then once this organization is done, the knowledge is accepted, it is stored. So the declarative attempt is having the three things: constructing the meaning, then organizing, and then storing. In the same dimension, we have got the second aspect, which is actually helpful for acquiring and integrating knowledge, and that is procedural knowledge, where the construction of models happen. They actually make a kind of strategy or a kind of model where they actually every child is making a kind of set of learning methods in which they actually learn this new knowledge. So they make a kind of model, the construction of model happens, and then they shape up this particular new knowledge in the way in which they are trying to acquire it. After the shaping up, they actually internalize this new knowledge. So this was acquisition and integration of knowledge. Then the third dimension is extend and refine knowledge. We all know that learning does not stop with acquiring and integrating knowledge. Learners develop in-depth understanding through the process of extending and refining their knowledge. For example, by making new distinctions, clearing up misconceptions or alternative frameworks, and reaching to conclusions. They basically rigorously analyze what they have learned by applying reasoning, that reasoning process that will help them extend and refine the information. Some of the common reasoning processes used by learners to extend and refine their knowledge are, we can just have a look on all those things. The first thing is comparing. Then we have got classification. So this comparing happens when we are making a comparison between what is new introduced to us with the knowledge which we have got previously. And then we classify that in which category this particular knowledge piece is actually occurring. And then we got we do the abstraction, the abstracting of things happen. Then we go on inductive reasoning. We actually get to have lots and lots of examples of that sort. And then after these, the collection of all those examples which are related to this new knowledge is basically done, then we go keep on deducting those examples. The most like plausible or the most important of those examples are kept and rest of them are deducted. So after the inductive reasoning, we have got the deductive reasoning. And then we have got the construction of support system. The support system, like we seek the acceptance or support from rest of the audiences or rest of the people who are from the same field. So this constructing support happens, and then we have got analyzing errors. We see that what exactly we have learned. If there is any error inside, we just try to analyze those errors and remove those errors. And then we have got analyzing perspectives. We want to see that whatever new knowledge we have acquired, we have to see that what is the perspective of others, or we actually try to analyze the perspectives related to that particular knowledge. And after this analysis, we keep on actually judging ourselves regarding this new knowledge, and once it is strengthened, then the internalization of this new knowledge happens. Then we come to the fourth dimension, which is using of knowledge meaningfully. The most effective learning occurs when we use knowledge to perform meaningful tasks. For example, we might initially learn about a skincare product by talking to a friend or viewing an advertisement in a magazine article or somewhere. If we have seen a skincare product, we just have some interest in that. But whenever we are going to buy this particular skincare product, then we will actually learn a lot about this product, and then only we will buy. So there is a difference between that. What exactly is just like we have got a cursory look, and then if we are very much interested, or we need to go and we have to acquire that particular knowledge for the sake of our development, then we actually develop a keen interest in that particular thing, and we actually learn that particular knowledge which is to be acquired. So making sure that students have the opportunity to use knowledge meaningfully is one of the most important parts of planning a unit of instruction. In the dimensions of learning model, which we will learn after like some time, we will be studying that in the next part of the lecture. There are six reasoning processes around which tasks can be constructed to encourage the meaningful use of knowledge. So for using knowledge meaningfully, what we do, in sequence we make decisions. So decision making happens, then we do problem solving, then we make inventions, we do lots and lots of search, and then we do experimental inquiry, then we do investigation and the system analysis. So all these things happen in sequence when we are using the knowledge meaningfully. So this was the fourth dimension. Then we come to the last and the final dimension, which is dimension number 5, and that is habits of mind. The most effective learners have developed powerful habits of mind that enable them to think critically, think creatively, and regulate their behavior. These mental habits are they comprise of different aspects. So the first aspect is critical thinking. Under the critical thinking, what we do, we actually try to be accurate and seek accuracy, be clear and seek clarity, maintain an open mind, restrain impulsivity, take a positive position when the situation warrants us to actually make ourselves apart from a situation. So we take a position, then respond appropriately to others' feelings and level of knowledge. So this was critical thinking. Then we have got creative thinking. So under the creative thinking, we have got we actually persevere. Then we have got, we have to push the limits of our knowledge and abilities. Then we have to generate trust and maintain our own standards of evaluation. Then we have to generate new ways of viewing a situation that are outside the boundaries of standard conventions. So this is something, all these activities happen under the creative thinking. Then the next aspect is the self-regulated thinking. So we monitor our own thinking, plan appropriately, identify and use necessary resources, respond appropriately to feedback, and evaluate the effectiveness of our actions. So this was the fifth dimension. So we have seen that in under this dimensions, the habit formation of the mind, like our mind is also responsible for habit formation. So in the fifth dimension, the habit formation of the mind happens. So with this, I must conclude this the topic of today. So this is all are the five dimensions of learning. In the next lecture, the part two of this particular lecture series, we will see that what exactly is the model which was given by Marzano. So till then, we will be just having a look on exactly what these five dimensions tell us. So thank you so much.